So, something not so chill happened a couple days ago. Hello, potential friends, and welcome back to the vlog. I can't do this. I wish I could tell you guys that I'm doing good, but a couple days ago I got my heart slam dunked into the ground with force equal to those alien guys from Space Jam. A couple days ago, the final chapter of the manga series Bleach came out. The end of a series I've been following since I was 11 years old. I used to get up early, all sparkly-eyed and excited, to watch illegally downloaded episodes of the anime before my parents got up and kicked me off the computer. I've continued reading the manga all these years, even past the writing getting progressively more plot-holy and shitty. I stuck with it because I loved the characters, and I loved the relationship between Ichigo and Rukia, whose meeting of fate, actually, like, there's literally a color spread poem for them about their meeting of fate. A boy, a soul reaper, a chance meeting, a story of fate begins. Dramatic as hell. Kickstarted the entire story. They uplifted each other and were each other's support in hard times, and understood each other in ways few other characters could, and had a bond that was one of the strongest I'd seen in any pieces of literature. Sparkly-eyed 11-year-old me would look at them and think, God, I want someone like that. I could see the potential for a beautiful, soul-bright romance, and I hoped with all my heart that it would happen. I held on to that hope. For 12 years. A couple days ago, the final chapter came out. And not only did Ichigo and Rukia not get together, but Ichigo got with Orihime, confirming the canonness of my no TP. No! God, please, no! Through the 5 stages of grief in like 10 minutes. I rocketed through that like I was being slingshotted to the moon. No, there's no way Ichime would happen. It's a bait and switch. The next few pages will show it. It's Aizen making them see things that aren't there. It literally makes no sense. Ichigo's never shown any signs of liking her romantically. Kubo just wouldn't do that with no development. He's not that stupid. I am going to fly to Japan and stand outside his house, screaming his name until he comes down the street to physically fight me. I am going to smother him in the hundreds of chapters he wrote where Ichigo and Rukia were perfect for each other. I am going to achieve Bankai purely for the sake of kicking his ass. If he takes it all back on Twitter and says it was a mistake, I'll forgive him. We all make mistakes. Maybe if we all get mad enough over him destroying his own story, he'll have to write a new ending. Love is dead. There's no such thing as love. I'm going to be 37 and my partner will propose to me for the 3rd time, and I'll say no yet again. And they'll say, why, Alexandra? Who hurt you this badly? And I'll say, I'm sorry. I just can't believe you do truly love me. Because on August 18th, 2016, I realize that love is a lie, and I can't trust my ability to perceive it in others. My grave beckons me. All is turning gray. After so long without significant Ichiruki interaction in the manga, when I found out it was ending so quickly, I did wonder if he was going to take it in Ichihime direction, since they had been fighting the final boss together. So even if there was no romantic development, there was at least that as warning. When I think about it without anger, there's a kind of poetry to the series beginning with Ichigo and Rukia meeting and ending with their kids meeting and no! And maybe it does make more sense.
Nope!
Because she did like him so long and—
No way!
Hey, I'm trying to be positive here!
Acceptance? Are you kidding?
The final chapter was a mess for more than just the most beautiful pairing on Earth being shafted for no reason. It was like Kubo Tite decided to shit on everything he'd established about the characters. Chad became a boxer, except he said he never wanted to use his fists for personal gain, and in fact met Ichigo because Chad wouldn't defend himself in a fight. Ishida became a doctor, despite the fact that he hated his father who was a doctor and said he would never become a doctor after what happened to his mother. Literally, like, what happened to his interest in fashion and design? That stuff made him happy. Also, I found it terribly sad that Chad wasn't physically there with them in the last chapter. He was always trying to keep up with Ichigo, but he was never as strong as him, and he couldn't truly watch Ichigo's back as they had promised, and there was always this distance between them that he hated and tried to close, and so him not even being there with them is so sad.
Chad and Ichigo becoming canon would have made more sense.
Also, Ishida was barely seen in this final chapter, even though the whole final arc was the Quincy War. The whole Quincy thing was really not solved. Is he the last Quincy again? I just don't even know. He was pushed aside so easily, especially his feelings for Orihime, which were dismissed for the sake of a shitty parallel to Ichigo's mom choosing Ichigo's dad over Ishida's dad. I'm sorry, but Ishida actually paid attention to Orihime. He actually listened when she spoke and understood her feelings, even when she didn't speak. Unlike Ichigo, who seemed to hold no connection to her at all other than, "You're my friend, and I will protect you." Also, superpowered babies? Stupid. And so many unanswered questions. What is keeping everything together now that there's no Soul King? What happened to the half dozen characters who were in the middle of battles that just didn't end or get explained? Are Urahara and Yoruichi dead? Did they really expect me to believe that Aizen allowed himself to be captured again after they let him out? Like, is he the Soul King now? Can you please be clear about that? Like, there are so many loose ends, I don't even know how to hold them all. But in my heart, I'm most upset about Ichigo and Rukia. They didn't need to get together. In fact, I pretty much didn't expect them to. I think they'd need more time for that than was given, though I fully expected a hug, or a handhold, or even just a gaze that cemented that yes, this is the relationship that matters most moving forward, and it will result in something later down the line. It's also totally possible for the most important relationship in your life to be a platonic friendship. I'm open to that. However, if Kuba wanted to place any girl with Ichigo romantically, the only option that made sense was Rukia, so having him end up with Orihime is a complete affront to all characters involved. Orihime's crush on Ichigo throughout the series was only detrimental to her. In the Huekomando arc, she lost it and just screamed his name over and over. And she hated herself for it afterwards. She hated the way she'd relied on him, and she wanted to be strong for herself. But then what happens? She says she's attained more power for Ichigo, and she fails to ever give herself the same kind of love she gives him. The more I think about it, the more sad I am for her character. It would have just been so much better for her if she'd moved on from him. That would have been so much more realistic development, recognizing that this is someone who you will always care deeply for, but they will not return your feelings, and so you move on, you collect yourself, you become someone without that person that you're always looking towards, you know? I honestly don't understand how Ichihime shippers are happy about this ending, considering that they didn't get the development within the manga necessary for the ending to make sense. We didn't see Ichigo fall in love with Orihime at all. Apparently it happened during the first year or so of the time skip, because they then went on to have a kid that was old enough to be a little baby Shinigami in the final chapter. So it was rushed and implausible, and gave off the impression that Kubo was just like, oh, I guess I'll make everyone heterosexually married and popping out babies with the person who is unrequitedly in love with them, even though they have no mutual chemistry.
Lol.
And what is Ichigo even doing in the last chapter? What is his job? Let's forget about that time he lost his powers and became massively depressed because he couldn't do the one thing he found self-worth in, i.e. protecting people with his powers. Yeah, it totally makes sense that he's not a Shinigami at the end and is just chilling, happy, in the apple pie life with Orihime. This last chapter was the most out-of-character mess of my life! Also, shifting all the amazing development and build-up and connection between Rukia and Ichigo onto their kids meeting and being like, hey, I mean, your favorite characters didn't get together, but all of that unresolved romantic potential is just passed along to their kids. Isn't poetic. It's lazy and disrespectful to the characters. I read the chapter in the morning and I cried in the car on my way to work. A pillar of my childhood of the last 12 years of my life had been yanked from me. I felt devastated and betrayed and unbelievably stupid. I have a degree in English. Analyzing literature is sort of my thing. The idea that I could have been so wrong, that I could have added everything up in the text only to come up with the wrong answer, was crushing and humiliating. How could I have believed so purely in Ichiruki? How come I didn't see this coming? And then I realized. you can write the greatest analysis in the world. Accurately find all the symbolism and signs and parallels in the text and build a beautiful, irrefutable argument. But you can't control the whims of a shitty writer. I wasn't wrong. We all weren't wrong. We just didn't account for Kubo shitting all over his own work. Ichiruki still happened. I didn't hallucinate that time Rukia scaled the side of a building instead of walking through the door just so she could impress her totally platonic friend, featuring a two-page spread of Ichigo staring at her in awe and then stammering her name for like four panels. He's like, oh my god, Rukia. And then like literally start the next chapter. He's still saying her name. He's like, Rukia, oh my god. Like, what? Like, this is the most extra thing I have ever seen in my entire life. He's looking at her like she's an angel that descended from heaven. Like she's literally the ray of light that Kubo, that motherfucker, described her as for Ichigo. What? Or you know, that time he desperately fought to save her in Soul Society, declaring his intent to every enemy he came across. And thinking of her constantly. Unlike that time in Hueco Mundo, when he was supposed to be focusing on saving Orihime, but lol, fighting Grimmjow was equally as important. I didn't imagine Ichigo and Rukia having the most dramatic ass goodbye when he lost his powers. I didn't imagine him looking down at her when he was wounded. Like he was watching his whole world crumble, and Orihime having to look away, sadly, because she was jealous AF. Like, what even is that face? I'm sorry. She knows what's up. She knows what's up. Orihime's not stupid. Unlike the writer. That time when Chad got hurt in Hueco Mundo and Ichigo pressed on because saving Orihime was what was at stake. But then when Rukia got hurt, he turns back instantly. Like, all this shit happened. Kubo wrote it. And one chapter doesn't undo all that. I didn't ship Ichiruki for 12 years just for the sake of a potential confirmation at the end. I shipped it because I felt it every step of the way. And yes, I'm sad and offended and angry about the way Rukia was sidelined during this final arc in a series where she's supposed to be the second protagonist, and the way Ichiruki was shipbaited for literally years with multiple poems and romantic color spreads and teasing quotes in interviews. But Kubo can't destroy Ichiruki. He created this monster. He's gotta deal with the havoc that it wrecks. There's approximately 1,000 extra other wrong things with this chapter. Rukia forgot her own child? Ichigo didn't know her kid, meaning that she named her child after him but then didn't visit in 10 years? But I will leave it here for today. If I come across any good fix-it fix that rewrites the shitty ending to one that actually makes sense, I will leave a link in the description below, so watch this space in the future. To any IRs feeling understandably shaken and upset, read some good fic, take care of yourself. To any IHs who watch this despite me not liking the ending, I'm happy you're happy, and I hope you have a good day. If you like this video, you can give it a thumbs up, and you can click Lambie's face to subscribe. I will see you guys next time, and I leave you with a few panels of Ichigo and Rukia's faces when they were looking at each other. It truly was the ship of dreams, and it will sail forever.